Scamander's Valley echoes to the wail of slaves, the captive women given to their masters now, while all the women of Troy, yet unassigned, are here, beneath the shelter of these walls, chosen to wait the will of princes, and among them, Tyndareus' child, Helen of Sparta, treated rightly as a captive slave. Nearby, beside the gates for any to look upon who has the heart, she lies face upward, Hecuba, weeping for multitudes, a multitude of tears. Polyxena, one daughter, even now was killed in secrecy and pain beside Achilles' tomb. Priam is gone, their children dead. One girl is left, the maiden Cassandra, crazed by Lord Apollo's stroke, whom Agamemnon, in despite of all the gods' will and all religion, will lead by force to his secret bed. Oh, city, long ago a happy place. Goodbye. Goodbye, human bastions. Pallas, child of Zeus, did this. But for her hatred, you might stand strong-founded still.
August amongst gods, a vast divinity, closest in kinship to Zeus, the father of all, may one who has quarreled with you in the past make peace and speak.
You may, Lady Athena, for the strands of kinship close drawn work no small magic to enchant the mind.
I thank you for your gentleness and bring you now questions whose issue touches both you and me, my lord.
Is this the enunciation of some new word spoken by Zeus or any of the other divinities?
No. For Troy's sake, whose ground we stand, I come to win the favor of your power as my ally.
You hated Troy once. Did you throw your head away and change to pity? Now its walls are black with fire.
Come, back to the question. Will you take counsel with me and help me gladly in all that I'll bring to pass?
I will indeed, but tell me what you wish to do. Are you here for the Achaeans or the Phrygians' sake?
For the Trojans, whom I hated for short time since, and for the Achaeans to make their homecoming a thing of sorrow.
This is a springing change of character. Why must you hate too hard and love too hard your loves and hates?
Did you not know? They outraged my temple and shamed me.
I know that Ajax dragged Cassandra thence by force.
And the Achaeans did nothing. They did not even speak.
Yet they captured Ilium by your strength alone.
True. And therefore help me. I would do some evil to them.
I am ready for anything you ask. What will you do?
Make their home voyage a most unhappy coming home.
While they stay here ashore or out on the deep sea?
When they take ship from Ilium and set sail for home, Zeus will shower down his rainstorm and weariously beat the hail to make black the bright sky with roaring winds. He has promised to my hand the gift of the blazing thunderbolt to dash and overwhelm the Achaean ships with fire. Yours is your own domain, the Aegean crossing. Make the sea thunder to the trip of wave and spin surf. Cram thick the hollow Euboean fold with floating dead, so the Greeks may learn to use with fear my sacred places and respect all gods' desires.
This shall be done, and joyfully. It needs no long discourse to tell you. I will shake the Aegean Sea, Mykonos' headlands, and the swine-back reefs of Delos, the Caphorean promontories, Scyros, Lemnos, shall take the washed-up bodies of men drowned at sea. Back to Olympus now. Gather the thunderbolts from your father's hands, then take your watcher's post to wait the chance when the Achaean fleet puts out to sea. That mortal
who sacks fallen cities is a fool if he gives the temples and the tombs, the hallowed places of the dead, to desolation. His own turn must come.
Stricken head, rise from the dust, lift up the throat. This is Troy, but Troy and we, Troy's kings, are perished. My sons! And my husband. Oh, massive pride that my father's heap to magnificence, you meant nothing.
Must I be hushed? Were it better thus? Should I cry and lament?
Unhappy, accursed. Limbs cramped, I lie backed on this stiff bed. Oh, head, oh, temples and sides, sweet to shift. Let the tired spine rest, weight eased by the sides, alternate against the strain of the tears' song, where wretched people find music yet. The song undanced of their wretchedness. You ship's prows at the rapid oar swept here to blessed Ilium. It was you ships that carried the fatal bride of Menelaus. Now she has killed the sire of the 50 sons, my husband, Priam. Me, unhappy Hecuba, she drove on this reef of ruin. Such state I keep to sit by the tents of Agamemnon. I am led captive from my house, an old, unhappy woman, like my city, ruined and pitiful. Come, sad wife of the Trojans, daughter. Brides of disaster, let us mourn the smoke of Ilium. And I, as among winged birds the mother, lead the clashing cry, the song. Not that song wherein once long ago, when Priam leaned on his scepter, my feet were queens of the choir, and led the proud dance to the gods of Phrygia.
Hecuba, what are these cries? What news now? Through the ten walls I heard your pitiful weeping, and fear shivered in the breasts of the Trojan women, who within so about the day of their slavery.
My children, the ships of the Argives will move today, the hands at the oar.
They will. Why? Must I bear ship so soon from the land of my fathers?
I know nothing. I look for disaster.
Alas, poor women of Troy, torn from your homes. Come, hear of miseries. The Argives push for home.
Oh, let her not come forth. Not now, my child Cassandra, driven delirious to shame us before the Argives. Not the mad one to bring fresh pain to my pain. Ah, no. Troy, ill-starred Troy, this is the end. Your last sad people leave you now, both living and broken.
Ah, me, trembling at the tents of
was stunned with terror in my soul, awakes into the door.
Has a herald come from the Nemeans yet? Whose wretched tale shall I be ordained?
You are near the lots now.
Alas, who will lead me away? And how life, turn our home, to furious, unhappy, surely, and far from Troy.
And I, whose wretched slave shall I be? Where in my grey age, a faint drone, poor image of a corpse, weak, shining among dead men? Shall I stand and guard at their door? Shall I nurse their children? I, who in Troy held stage as a princess.
So pitiful your shame and your lamentation.
I shall look no more on the houses of my parents, no more. I shall have worse troubles.
Shall I be forced to the bed of weak masters? I curse of night and my fortune.
Might I only be taken to Athens, domain of Theseus the bright.
Never in the well of Eurytus. Not Sparta detested who gave us Helen.
Not look with slave's eyes of the scourge of Troy, Menelaus.
See now, from the house of the Nereids of the herald, charge new orders. Take the speed of his way toward us. What message, what command, since we count as slaves even now in Dorian kingdom?
Hecuba, incessantly my way has led me to Troy, as messenger of the Achaean armament. You know me from the old days, my lady. I have been sent to Talthybius with new messages for you to hear.
It comes, beloved daughters of Troy, the thing I fear.
You have all been given your masters now. Was this your dread?
Yes. Is it fear then? The city of Thessaly? Tell me, the land of Cadmus?
All are allotted separately, each to a man.
Who is given to whom? Oh, is there any hope left for the women of Troy?
I understand, yet us not for all, but for each apart.
Who was given my child? Tell me who shall be lord of my poor abused Cassandra.
King Agamemnon chose her. She was given to him.
Slave woman to that Lacedaemonian wife? Unhappy child.
No, rather to be joined with him in a dark bed of love.
Was virgin, blessed in the privilege the Godhead God gave her, a life forever unwed.
Love's archer and the prophetic maiden struck him hard.
Dash down, my daughter, the twigs of your consecration. Break the God's garland to your throat again.
Is it not high favour to be brought before a king's bed?
And my poor youngest whom you took away, where is she?
You spoke now of Polyxena, is it not so?
To whose arms did the lots force her?
She is given a guardianship to serve Achilles' tomb.
To serve my child over a tomb? Tell me, is this their way, some law established among the Greeks?
Speak of your child in words of blessing. She feels no pain. She lives her destiny, and her cares are over now.
And the wife of bronze and metal Hector, tell me of her. I promise you this law. What shall she suffer now?
The son of Achilles chose her. She was given to him.
And I? In my aged frailty, whom shall I serve?
You should be slave to Odysseus, lord of Ithaca.
Oh, no. Tear the shorn head, rip nails through both cheeks, must I? To be given to serve a slave to that vile, that slippery man, right's enemy, brute, murderous beast, that mouth of lies and treachery that makes void faith in things promised and turns to hate all that was beloved. Oh, mourn, daughters of Ilium, weep as one for me. I am gone, doomed, undone. Oh, wretch, given the worst lot of all.
My orders are to bring Cassandra to the general at once, and afterwards I can bring to the rest of the princes their allotted captive women. But see, what is that burst of a torch flame inside?
can it mean?
Are the Trojan women setting fire to their chambers at the point of being torn from their land to sail for Argos? Have they set themselves aflame in longing for death? Ah, I know it is the way of freedom in times like these to stiffen the neck against disaster. Open there! Open! Let not the fate desired by these and dreaded by the Achaeans hurl their wrath on me!
You are wrong. They are not setting fire. It is my Cassandra, whirled out on running feet in the passion of her frenzy.
Lift up. Heave up. Carry the flame. I bring fire of worship. Torture to the temple. I, your Hymen, my lord. Bless the right room. Blessed am I indeed to lie at a king's side. Bless the word of Argos. Hymen! My lord! You swore the tears, my mother. You swore the lamentation for my father fallen, for your city so dearly loved. And mine this marriage, my marriage. And I shake out the torch flare, brightness, dazzle, light for you. Hymen! Stones ordains. Let your feet dance, rippling the air. Let the chorus go, and find my father's faithfulness and blessedness. Oh, sacred, sacred dance. Lead now. Phoebus Apollo, I wear your laurel. I tend your temple. Oh, Hymen! Dance, mother. Dance, laugh, lead. Let your feet wind in the shifting pattern. And follow mine. Keep the sweet step with me. Cry out the bride's name in the shrill and the blessed incantation. You daughters of free devils in splendor, dance for my wedding, for the husband's fate appointed to lie beside me.
Can you not, Queen Hecuba, stop this bacchanal before her light feet whirl her away to the Argo camp?
Fire god, in mortal marriages you lift up your torch, but here you throw a melancholy light, not seen through my hopes that went so high in days gone past. Oh, child, there never was a time I dreamed you went like this at spear's edge under force of Argive arms. But we take the light, crazed, passionate. You cannot carry it straight enough. Poor child, your fate is intemperate as you are. Oh, there is no relief for you.
Mother, sound my hair with flower and victory. This is a king, eh, Mary? Then be glad. Escort the bride. And if she falters, thrust her strongly on. cried, great Agamemnon, as one a wife more fatal than ever Helen was. For I will kill him and avenge my brother's blood and my father's in the desolation of his house. But I leave this in silence. Seek not now the axe dropping at my throat, another thrust than mine. The agony of the mother murdered come to pass from our marriage rites, and Atreus' house made desolate. I am ridden by God's curse too. Yet I would set so far out of my frenzy as to show our city is blessed beyond the Epians. For one woman's sake, one act of love, these hunted Helen down and threw thousands of lives away. They are general, clever men. In the name of a vile woman, cut his darling down. Gave up for a brother the sweetness of children in his house. All to bring back that brother's wife. A woman who went of a free will, not caught in constraint of violence. The Achaeans came beside Scamander's legs and died. Day after day, the nuns sought to wrench their land from them, nor their own towering cities. Both the war god court never saw their sons again. Nor were the later raised decently in winding sheets by the wise's hands, but lay buried in alien ground. While all went wrong at home, where widows perished, and couples who had raised their children in vain were left childless. No one left to tear their tombs or give them the sacrificial blood. For such success as this, congratulate the Greeks. No, but the shame is better left in silence, or fear my singing voice become the voice of wretchedness. The Trojans had their glory, which is loveliest. They died for their own country. So that all the bodies are to the spears, carried home in loving hands, brought to the land of their fathers, to the embrace of earth, and buried becomingly as the right fell due. Those Phrygians who escaped death in battle, day by day came home to happiness the Achaeans could not know. Their wives, their children. Then was Hector's fate so sad? You think so? Listen to the truth. He's dead and gone, surely. But with reputation as a valiant man. How could these be except for the Achaeans coming? Had they held back, none would have known how great he was. The wife of Paris was the daughter of Zeus. Had he not married her, his wife's name would sleep in endless silence. Though surely the wise man will forever shrink from war, yet if war comes, the hero is dead. Lay your wish not less. The coward does not bring shame! Let no one choose for mother, not for our land, and not for this marriage, Amy. It is by marriage that I bring to destruction those whom you and I have hated most.
Were it not that Apollo is to enlarge your wits, I would make you sorry for sending the princes of our host on their way home in augury of foul speech like this. Now, pride of majesty and wisdom's outward show have fallen to stature less than what was nothing worth, since he, almighty prince of the assembled Hellenes, Atreus, his son beloved, have fallen in love with a crazed girl. I, Apollo, plain man would not marry this woman or keep her as my lover. You then, with your wits unhinged by idiocy, your scolding of Argos, and your Trojans glorified, I throw to the winds to scatter them. Come with me now to the ships. A bride, and such a bride, for Agamemnon. Hecuba, when Laertes calls you, be sure you follow. If what Odo visited Ilium say is true, you would at least be a virtuous woman's slave.
You yourself have done a bad thing! Oh, how can heralds keep their name of honor? Lackeys to a despot be they, or lackeys to the people. Oh, men must despise them still. You tell me that my mother must be slave in the house of Odysseus. Where are all Apollo's promises uttered to me? To my own ears. And Hecuba would die in the fire. What else awaits her? But enough. Poor wretch. He little dreams of what he must go through. When he will think Troy's pain and mine will golden grace beside his own luck. 10 years he's been here, and 10 more years will follow before he at last comes home. Forlorn after the rock and the thin-shaped Charybdis. The mountain striding Cyclops who eats men's flesh. The legion which returns men into swine, Circe. The wreck of all his ships on the salt sea. The lotus passion. The sacred oxen of the sun slaughtered. Their dead flesh mourning into speech. To make Odysseus listening shiver. Cut the story short. He will go down to the water of death. And return alive. To reach his home, and a thousand sorrows waiting there. Why must I hold forth each of Odysseus' labors one by one? Lead the way quick to the house of death, where I shall take my mate. Lord of all the sons of Danaus, haughty in your mind of pride, not by day, but evil in the evil night, you shall find your grave. When I lie a corpse cold and naked next my husband's sepulchre, piled in the ditch for animals to reap and feed on, beaten by screaming storms of winter, I, who wore Apollo's sacraments, garlands of the god I loved so well, prophetic spirit's dress, leave me as I leave those festivals where once I was so proud. See? I tear your adornments for my skin, not yet defiled by touch. Throw them to the running winds to carry off. Oh, Lord of prophecy. Where is Agamemnon's ship then? Lead me where I would set my feet on board. Wait for the wind of favor in the sails. Here when the ship got out from this shore, she carries one of the 3 Furies in my shame. Men of my senses. Goodbye. Mother, weep no more for me. You beneath the ground, my brothers. Priam, father also, I shall be with you in 7. I will come triumphant to the land of the dead, leaving behind me wrecked the house of Atreus, which destroyed our hearts.
No. Let me lie where I have fallen. O gods, What wretched things to call on gods for help, although the decorous action is to invoke their aid, when all our hands lay hold on is unhappiness.
Voice of singing, stay with me now, for Ilil's sake. Take up the burden of tears, new song of sorrow. The dirge for Troy's death must be chanted.
I was a princess, who was once a prince's bride, mother by him of sons preeminent, not just mere numbers of them, but the lords of the Phrygian domain. And then I saw them fall before the spears of Greece, and cut my hair for them, and laid it on their graves.
The tale of my enslavement by the wheel stride of the four-foot beast of the Argives, the horse they left in the gates, thin golden cheeks, inward the spear's high thunder.
I mourned their father Priam. None told me the tale of his death. I saw it with these eyes. I stood to watch his throat cut at the altar of the protecting god. I saw my city taken, and the girls I nursed matured to be dragged by hands of strangers from my arms.
Our people, thronging the rock of Troy, roared out the great cry, the war is over, go down, bring this sacred wood idol to the maiden of Ilium, Zeus' daughter.
There is no hope left that they will ever see me more, no hope that I shall ever look on them again. Now I must be carried away to Hellas, an old slave woman, where all those tasks that rack old age shall be given me by my master.
And the generation of Troy swept solid to the gates to give the goddess her pleasure, the horse immortal, unbroken, the nest of Argive spears.
I must work the bolt that bars their doorway, or bake their bread. Lay down these withered limbs to sleep on the bare ground, whose bed was royal once.
Then the cry went up, sudden, bloodshot, up and down the city, to stun the keeper of the citadel. Children reached shivering hands to clutch at the mother's dress. War stopped from his hiding place. Pallas did this. Beside the altars, the Trojans died in their blood.
My poor Polyxena. Where are you now? Not here, nor any boy or girl of mine who were so many once is near me in my unhappiness. And you would lift me up from the ground? What hope? What use?
Hecuba, look. I see the boy Astyanax, Hector's sweet child.
I go at the hands of Greek masters.
Alas.
Master incantation. Of my own grief being steals from you.
It must, O Zeus.
My own distress.
Oh, my children.
Once, no longer.
Lost. Troy, our dominion.
Unhappy.
And my lordly children.
Gone.
Sad they were mine.
Sorrows only.
Sad destiny.
Oh, forsaken.
A wreck and burning.
Come back, O my husband.
Poor child, you invoke a dead man, my son once.
My defender. Oh. You who once killed the Greeks.
Oh, the sons I bore to Priam.
Take me to my death now. Longing for death drives thee.
Sorrowful, oh, such is our fortune.
Well, so see.
And our pain lies deep under pain piled over.
We are the hated of the gods. Since once your youngest, escaping death, brought down Troy's towers in the arms of a worthless woman.
Piled in the palace.
The bleeding bodies of our young men sprawled.
God's food. While Troy takes on the yoke of captivity.
Oh, my city forlorn.
Abandoned, I weep.
Miserable last hour.
Of the house where I bore my children.
Oh, my sons, this city and your mother are desolate of you. Sound of lamentation and sorrow, tears on tears shed. Home, farewell. The dead have forgotten all sorrows.
They who are sad find somehow sweetness in tears, the song of lamentation and the melancholy muse.
Hecuba, mother of the man whose spear was death to the Argives. Hector!
Do you see what they have done to us?
I see the work of gods who pile tower high the pride of those who were nothing and dash prison granted down.
We are carried away. Sad spoils, my boy and I, our life transformed. We, who were noble, have now become mere slaves.
Such is the terror of necessity. I lost Cassandra, roughly torn from my arms before you came.
And our agents, harm your daughter? Sons of thing it must be.
Yet we have lost two more than you yet know.
There is no numbering my losses.
Infinitely misfortune comes to our race, misfortune known before.
Polyxena is dead. They cut your daughter's throat to pleasure her dead Achilles' corpse above his grave.
Oh, wretched. This was what Tiberius meant. That speech cryptic, incomprehensible, yet now so clear.
I saw her die and left this wagon seat to lay her over upon her body and sing the threnody.
Poor child. Poor wretched, wretched darling. Sacrificed in pain to a dead man. What monstrous sacrilege.
She died. And this was death indeed. And yet to die, I assured you it was happier than to live as I live now.
Oh, no, child, no. No life, no light is any kind of death, since death is nothing. And in life, the hopes live still.
Oh, mother. Oh, mother. Hear me while I reason through this matter fully, might it even hush your grief. Death, I'm sure, is like never being born, but death is better thus by far than to live a life of pain.
Since the dead,
with no perception of evil, feel no grief, why he, who was happy once and now unfortunate, finds his heart driven far from his own lost happiness?
She died.
It is as if she never saw the light of day, for she knows nothing now of what she suffered. But I, who aimed the arrows of a mission high at Tana and made them do,
see now how far I fall.
I, who in Hector's house walked out of costumes that bring discretions, named women.
Blame them or blame them not.
There is one act that sneaks the scandal and speeds away. To leave the house and walk abroad.
I long to do it.
But with the longing aside, and stayed always within the enclosure of my own house abroad. The witty speech some women cultivate I would not practice, but kept my honest inward thought, and made my mind my only sufficient teacher. Of the choice of women, Achilles' son picked me from the rest
to be his wife.
A murderous house!
And I shall be his slave.
If I dash, the beloved memory of Hector, and open wide my heart to my new lord, I shall be a traitor to the dead love and know it. If I cling faithful to the past, I win my master's hatred.
Hear me say that.
One night of love suffices to dissolve a woman's aversion, to share the bed of any man. When I hide great in understanding, rank, wealth, courage, all my wish. I was a virgin when you took me from the house of my father. I gave you all my maiden love, my first.
And now you're dead. And I must cross the sea to serve. Prisoner of war!
Slave's yoke, my neck.
In grace!
No, Hecuba.
Can you not see that my fate is wars and her divorce for Lixenus? That one thing left always while life lasts, hope.
Is not for me.
I keep no secret deception in my heart. It lured me to dream that I shall be ever happy anymore.
Odysseus, he urged you before the Greeks and got his way.
Oh, this is too much grief and more than anyone could bear.
He argued a hero's son cannot be allowed to live.
Oh, even thus may someday his own sons find no voice.
He must be hurled down the battlements of Troy. Let it happen this way. It would be wiser in the end. Do not fight it. Take your grief nobly as you were born. Give up the struggle where your strength is feebleness, with no force anywhere to help. Listen to me. Your city is gone. Your husband is gone. You are in our power. What can one woman hope to struggle against the arms of Greece? Think then. Give up the passionate contest. Don't do any shameful thing or any deed of hatred, and please, I request you hurl no curse at the Achaeans, but fear the army. Savage over some reckless word, forbid the child his burial, and the dirge of honor. Be brave, be silent, and out of such patience, be sure that the child you leave behind will not lie unburied here. And that to you the Achaeans will be less unkind.
humanity in the end. I nursed for nothing that swaddled baby at this mother's breast. In vain the rock of labor pains and the long weakness. Greed. Your great cleverness is simply my barbarity. Why will you kill this child that never did you any harm? A curse!
Those lovely accursed eyes brought down to shame and loom the broad plains of Troy.
Spartan once my own, whose name I can no longer speak with any happiness. To take her away. In this house of captivity, she's numbered among the other women of Troy. Slain. And those men whose work with the spear has won her back gave her to me. Hail. Or not kill. But to lead a life to land of arms, if such be my pleasure. And such it is. The death of Helen in Troy I will let pass. Half the oars
Take her back by sea, west back to Greek soil. I dare bring her over to execution. Block pen off a French sword, dead in you here. I want the winds blow faster. We will take ship again and bring her back to Hellas.
Whosoever you be, name's use, nature's necessity or mortal mind. I call upon you, for you walk the path none here, yet bring all human action back to right at last.
What can you mean? How strange the way to call on the gods.
Kill your wife, Menelaus, and I will bless your name. But keep your eyes away from her. Desire will win. She looks enchantment, and where she looks, homes are set fire. She captures cities as she captures the eyes of men. We've had experience, you and I. We know the truth.
And enough. Your first acts are a dread of terror to come. Your lackeys put your hands on me. I'm dragged out of my chambers by brute force. I know you hate me, I'm almost sure. There is one question I would ask you if I may. What have the Greeks decided to do with me? Shall I be allowed to live?
You are not strictly condemned. But all the army gave you into my hands to kill you for the wrong you did me.
Is it for me to let I argue this and prove that my death, if I am put to death, will be unjust?
I did not come to talk to you. I came to kill.
No, Menelaus. Listen to her. She should not die unhurt. But give me leave to make the opposite case, the prosecution. There are things that happened in Troy which you know nothing of, and the long-drawn argument will mean her death. She can never escape us now.
This. It's a gift of pleasure. Yet, if she wants to speak, she may. But it's for your sake, I understand that I gave this privilege that I never would have given her.
Perhaps it will make no difference if I speak well or badly. And your hate will not let you answer me. All I can do is to foresee the arguments you will use in accusation of me, and set against the force of your charges, charges of my own. First then. She mothered the beginning of all this wickedness, for Paris was her child. And next to her, the old king, who would not destroy the infant Alexander. That dream of the firebrand's agony has ruined Troy and me. But this is not all. Listen to the rest I have to say. Alexander was the judge of the goddess Trinity. Pallas Athena would have given him the power to lead the Phrygian arms on Hellas and make it desolate. All Asia was Hera's promise, and not the most souls of Europe, his lordship, is her way to reign. But Aphrodite, marveling at my loveliness, promised it to him, if he will say her beauty surpassed all others. Think what this means and all the consequence. Cyprus prevailed, and I was won in marriage, all for Greek advantage. You are not ruled by barbarians. You have not been defeated in war, nor serve a tyrant. Your Hellas fortune was my own misfortune. I, sold once for my body's beauty, stand accused. Who should for what has been done wear garlands on my head? I know you will say all this is nothing to the immediate charge. I did run away. I did go secretly from your house, but when he came to me, calling me the name you will, Paris or Alexander, he came with a goddess at his side, no weak one. And you? You was criminal. Took ship for Crete and left me there in Sparta in the house alone. You see? I wonder, and I ask this of myself, not you,
Why did I do it? What made me run away from home and betray my country and my heart? Challenge the goddess then. Show your strength greater than Zeus has the other gods in his power and steal his slave to Aphrodite alone. Shall I not be forgiven? See, you might have some show of argument against me. When Paris was gone to the deep places of death and my marriage given by the gods was gone, I should have come back to the Argive ships, left Troy. I did try to do it and I had witnesses. The tower with gatekeepers and the sentinels on the walls who caught me again and again as I let on the rope from the battlements and tried to slip away to the ground. As for Deiphobus, my second husband, he took me away by force and kept me his wife against the Phrygian's will. My husband, can you kill me now and think you're killing righteousness? I was the bride of four. Besides, my natural beauty brought me the sorrow of slavery instead of victory. Are you stronger than the gods? Try then. But any such ambition is absurd.
O Queen of Troy, stand by your children and your country. Break down the garment of this woman, for she seeks to wear what has done willingly.
This is dangerous.
First, to defend the honor of the gods, and show that the woman is a scandalous liar. Tell me the reason Hera should fall so much in love with the idea of beauty, to win some other lord more powerful than Zeus. Do not trick out your own sins by calling the gods stupid. No wise man will believe you. You claim that I must laugh to hear it, that Aphrodite came at my son's side to the house of Menelaus. Nonsense. My son was handsome beyond all other men. You saw him in the barbaric splendor of his robes, gorgeous with gold. It made your senses itch. You thought being queen only in Sparta, in little luxury. But once you got rid of Sparta for the Phrygian city where gold streamed everywhere, you could let extravagance run wild. No longer were Menelaus and his house sufficient for your spoiled, luxurious appetites. So much for that. You say you were taken away by force. What Spartan heard you cry for help? Did you cry? And then when you reached Troy, in the ships of the Argives at your heels came, when the reports came in that Menelaus was sightless women, you praised. Simply to make my son unhappy at the strength of his love challenger, forgetting your husband when the luck went back to Troy. You worked hard, not to make yourself a better woman, but to be sure to be always on the winning side. You claim you tried to slip away from the ramparts with ropes let down, and that this proves you stayed against your will. Perhaps. But when were you ever caught in a strangling noose or sharpening a dagger, which any noble wife would do, desperate with longing for her lord's return? Yet over and over again I gave you good advice. Make your escape, my daughter. There are other girls for my sons to marry. I'll help you get away to the ships of the Achaeans. Let the Greeks and us stop fighting. So I argued, but you were not pleased. Spoiled in the luxury of Alexander's house, you'd like foreigners to kiss the ground before your feet. All that pleased you. And now you dare to come outside, figure fastidiously arranged, to look on the same sky as your husband. Oh, abominable heart, you should walk submissively in rags of robes, head fine and cropped, your old impudence gone and modesty gained at last with reference to your sinful life.
Oh, Menelaus, mark this the end of my argument. Be true to your high reputation and to Hellas. Grace both and kill Helen. Thus make it the custom toward all womankind hereafter that the price of adultery is death.
Menelaus, keep this sorrow out of your house. Punish your wife and clear your name of the accusation of cowardice. You shall sing great even to your enemies.
All you have set forth in line with my own thought. This woman left my household for a stranger's bed, or for her own free will. And all this talk of Aphrodite is for pure show. Away! And face the stones of them all. Atone for the long labors of your kings in your brief act of dying, and know your penance to my shame! Enough, Hecuba. I'm not listening to her now. I'll take her away to where the ships are beached. She will make the voyage home.
But let her not be put in the same ship with you.
What do you mean?
A man once in love is never out of love again.
Sometimes. When the beloved's heart turns false to him. Yet, you shall be as you wish. She shall not be alone in the same ship I sailed. This is well advised. And once back in Argos, she will die the vile death earned by her vile life. Be an example to all women. All women to live temperately. It's not the easier way. Yet her execution will teach you with fear the lust of women even more depraved than her.
Oh, my dear, my husband, O wandering ghost unwashed, unburied, the sea hull must carry me in the flash of its wings speed to Argos, city of horses, where the stone walls built by giants invade the sky. The multitudes of our children stand clinging to the gates and cry through their tears, and one girl weeps, O mother, the Achaeans take me away lonely from your eyes to the black sheep where the old deep surf towards Salamis the blessed, or the peak between two seas where Pelops' castle keeps the gates of the isthmus.
Trojans, this is Astyanax, dead, dashed without pity from the walls.
Hecuba, one last ship, that of Neoptolemus, that of Achilles' son, remains. Man that the oar sweeps now, to carry home his last spoils of war. Neoptolemus himself is put to sea, and took with him Andromache, whose lamentations for her country, and farewells to her husband soon as she departed, brought these tears crowding into my eyes. And she implored that we bury this dead child. Your own Hector's son, who died flung from the battlements of Troy. He should be laid in your arms to be wrapped about with winding sheets and flowers, as best as you can out of that which is left to you. For she is gone. and your master's speed prevented her from giving the rites of burial to her little child. The rest of us, once the corpse is laid out and earth is piled above it, must raise the mast tree and go. Do therefore quickly everything you must do. For as one neighbour and myself have spared you. As we forded our way here across Scamander's running water, I washed the body and made clean the wounds. I will bring round and dig the grave for him. For my work be made brief, as yours must be, and let our tasks end together, and the ship be put to sea for home.
Kians, all your strength is in your spears, not in the mine. What were you afraid of that it made you kill this child so savagely? Oh, child, how wretched was this death. You might have fallen fighting for your city, grown to man's age, married, and with a king's power like a god's, and died happy. There is any happiness here. Now I, a homeless, childless old woman, must bury your poor corpse, which is so young. Alas, all the tendernesses, my nursing care and our shared slumbers gone. What would the poet say? What words might he inscribe upon your monument? Here lies a little child the Argives killed because they were afraid of him. That, the epitaph of Greek shame.
Here is what is left to take the corpse of burial.
Helen has destroyed you, she who as well has killed you and brought to ruin all our house.
My heart, you touched my heart. You who were once a great lord in my city.
Here are flowers for you, who die not, yet are dead in this body, since it is better far to honour you than the armour of Odysseus, the wicked and clever.
Ah me, earth takes you, child, our tears of sorrow. Cry aloud, our mother.
Yes.
The dirge of the dead.
Ah me.
He looks never to be forgotten.
Among the dead, your father will take care of the others.
Rip, tear your flesh with hands that beat like oars. Alas.
Dear women.
Hecuba, speak to us. We are yours. Where did you cry aloud?
Hide the corpse in this poor tomb. He has those flowers that are the right of the underworld. I think it makes small difference to the dead if they are buried in tokens of luxury. All that is empty glorification left for those who live.
Sad mother, whose thoughts were so used for your life, they are broken now. Born to high blessedness and a lowly line, child, your death was horror.
But see. See on the high places of Ilium, the torch bears whirling in the hands of men, for Troy is some other new agony.
The captains have their orders to set fire to the city of Priam. The shining flame will be kept no longer in the hand, the fire will be let loose upon it. And once the citadel of Ilium is broken to the ground, we will take leave of Troy in gladness, and go home. I speak to you too, for my orders include this, daughters of Troy. When the lords of the armament sound the high echoing crash of the trumpet call, then go to the ships of the Achaeans to be taken away from your land. And you, unhappiest and aged woman, go with them. For Odysseus' men are here, to whom enslaved the lot exiles you from your native land.
End and goal of all sorrows lived before. I go forth from my country in a city lit with flames. Come, aged feet, make one last weary struggle that I may hail my city in its affliction. Oh, Troy, they are burning you and us they drag forth from our land enslaved. Oh, gods! Do I call upon the gods for help? We cried to them before now, and they did not hear. Come now,
Let us hurl ourselves into the pyre, best to die in the flaming ruins of our father's house.
Unhappy creature. Ecstatic in your sorrows, you are Odysseus' property! And I have orders to deliver you into his hands!
Oh, sorrow, Cronium, Zeus, Lord of Phrygia, Prince of our house! Have you seen the dishonor done to the seed of Dardanus?
He has seen, but the great city is a city no more. It is gone, there is no choice.
Oh, sorrow, Ilium flares, the chains of Pergamon take fire, the citadel, the walls, high places.
Our city falls to the spear of fate, the small wind in the sky, all caught in the sweat, fire, and the fear of madness.
Oh, soil where my children grow.
Alas!
Oh, children, hear me, it is your mother who calls.
They are dead, you are right, you. This is our
mourn for the ruined city, then go away to the ships of the Achaeans.